I think it's very clear that among three of us here, I'm the youngest, as you can see very clearly. These two older people are next to me, but I'm going to learn from them because I'm known as a crime fiction writer and a thriller writer, and I've experimented with writing romance, and my first ever full-blown romance novel was published in June this year, and in that capacity, I'm being a romance writer and part of this panel. But let me first ask Faraz. Faraz, we've been knowing each other for the last,
8 years, I guess.
Eight years.
But we're meeting for the first time.
We're meeting for the first time.
The world of social media.
but I have this, you know, feeling that I already know so much about you. So Truly, Madly, Deeply was your book that came out in the beginning, and all of us felt its presence because it was very well received, as also pointed out in the introduction. But you've graduated, and you know, now you've got 5 books to your credit, and Meant to Be Together is your latest book. So tell us briefly about your journey, how you started with Truly, Madly, Deeply, and the in-between books that you've written, and here. Has it changed you as a person, or why did you choose these themes, etc.?
So I grew up reading romance. Actually, I used to read a lot, but romance was one of my favorite genres, right? And when I finally wanted to write a book, pen down one, that was the go-to choice. But again, coming from where I was, I needed some kind of an easy fodder, right? And there was a short story which I had written back in my 9th grade for the Asian Age Short Story Writing Competition. And that time it had won the consolation prize. I was the youngest of the winners. I was about 14 then, right? And so when I actually wanted to write a book, it so happened I was cleaning my house and I came across this handwritten short story, and that time it was titled First Love. And then the thought just occurred, okay, this is novel material. I just have to kind of expand on it and do all the mirch masala that us writers do. Add some mirch masala to it and it would be a novel. But I realized writing was the easier part. Being a first-time writer, getting it published was, much more difficult. And then finally marketing it was a different ball game altogether. So my writing journey typically helped me, grow into a much more tough person, right? Learn to take more rejections, right? Learn to kind of be a better marketer, which also ended up being my professional, route that I took, ended up becoming a digital marketer, right? So if it wasn't for my writing, I wouldn't have turned into digital marketing. And if I wasn't a digital marketer, maybe I wouldn't have achieved the success that I have achieved as a writer, getting, my books noticed out there. So the journey is like, it's a constant route of learning on the go. And I'm happy doing that still now.
Okay, but tell me, you've been writing romance novels, but why romance? Why have you not picked up any other theme? And how personally it is, do you have a girlfriend? Are you married? What stage are you in?
Yeah, I'm married, yeah.
So oh, you're married, wife, okay, yeah. Great. So that also happened because of your books or what?
No, not really. So I do everything online. So right from my grocery to my shopping, everything happens on Amazon or a Big Basket. My shadi also happened on shadi.com. So from my grocery to my wife, everything is online.
So it's very interesting. You know, you're writing these love stories, and I thought probably for a reason, my reason of writing love stories is different. I've been married for 20 years, but I thought probably, youngsters write love stories, chalo love story likh lete hain, fir kahin na koi ladki mil jayegi aur bada aasan ho jayega kaam. To wo aapne koshish ki hua
nahi. That's the general perception, but yeah, reality is very different. Perception is very different. Yes, but I have written a horror book. My second book, The Other Side.
After marriage or before marriage?
No, not much of a difference, but before marriage. Was too late to correct that. So my second book, The Other Side, was co-authored with another doctor, Dr. Vivek Banerjee. It is one of India's highest selling horror titles, commercial horror titles. It was also received well in the market. So that was the only time I, tried to experiment other than romance. A lot of people still asking me when I'll write a sequel to The Other Side. So that's still work in progress. the next one that I'd be working on would again be a romance. So I don't know. Professional life keeps me busy, and I'm more of a moody writer. So the muse strikes, and that's when you take up the pen. Some days I would be writing about 10,000 words. For 2 months, I would be writing nothing at all. So I never know.
So did I hear it correctly? You said you're a movie writer?
Moody writer.
Moody writer. Yeah. Okay. So that, thank you so much, and very interesting response. That takes me to Aditya Nigot, who's a doctor. So doctor writing a romance novel. I'm just trying to wrap my head around this. So how do you get time? Because the doctors that I know, they're always on call and so busy. And I don't think any doctor that I know has got time for romance. So how's it different for you?
So the real journey as... So the real journey as a doctor begins in the internship. So that's after 4.5 years. But I started writing when I was 17, but I didn't publish the book. This book I started writing when I turned 19. So it took me around 3 to 6 months to write, and then another couple of years to find a publisher, because that's the most difficult task for a debutant.
Okay, yeah. But then you have a good publisher now, and I believe this book is done very well. It's called Until Love Sets Us Apart, and this has been published by Fingerprint, which is one of the leading publishers. So how old is this book?
So it got published last year in September 2018, so that's exactly 1 year ago. And so since then we've managed to sell roughly 15,000 copies.
Wow, that's a big number.
Yeah, all credits to Fingerprint, of course.
Okay.
And the response is positive since then. Like now my next book is coming out this September.
So what has been your experience? I mean, what did this book get for you? I mean, apart from, of course, lots and lots of money. Are you married? Did it get you girlfriend?
No.
Oh, so girlfriend mili iske likhne ke baad?
So it's complicated.
Oh, it's complicated. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, theek hai. So, but tell us briefly about this Until Love Sets Us Apart. Because I do have a copy and I intend to start reading it immediately. But tell us about it. Give us a bit of a teaser.
Yeah.
Give us good reason for us to read and others to read as well.
So basically, it's a love story, medical love story. So the character Rohit and Aisha, the characters Rohit and Aisha are medical students. They fall for each other, but there's something which stands against them. So many a times we see that there's a love triangle or there's a quadrangle, we can say. But here, destiny stands against them. So they both love each other, marriage is on cards. But still, there's something that, it spoils their relationship. Okay,
so they have an obstacle. They like each other, but there's an obstacle. Then what happens? I mean, is that giveaway suspense? Do they get together?
It's a giveaway suspense.
Okay. Is it set in Pune or where is it set, the story?
It's set in Pune, and the story begins with 4 murders. And
so it isn't romance after all, it's got murders as well. Okay, that makes it more interesting, I think.
Yeah, and Rohit is charged for these murders. So is he innocent or what is the story like? So that's what readers have to find out.
Okay. Faraz, on that note, tell us a little bit about Meant to Be Together. What is it about?
So Meant to Be Together, so far, this has been one of my most challenging works because it's actually inspired from a real life person I know. An artist. I haven't even changed the character's name. It's actually the same. So you can look her up, Preeti Thakur Arora. Obviously, there are elements of fiction because ultimately I'm writing a novel, right? And I have to take the liberty that most writers do. So Meant to Be Together is actually a tale of not giving up on hope when you are seeing your darkest days. So Preeti Thakur Arora, who has been abused as a kid, who suffers from dyscalculia. And so she, has seen this turbulent times, and as a young woman, when she grows up, she's finally learning to set her wings free after being dependent, after being in a nutshell, like, and she's finally learning to be a butterfly. And that's when she loses the only person, who's ever close to her, her brother. So how her brother's death affects her and how she ends up losing it all, whatever she has achieved, that she had gathered, the courage, the confidence in all these years. and how she overcomes it, how painting is a channel that helps her overcome it all, or whether the channel is love, because suddenly, as she's about to commit suicide, you know, the bell rings and in comes an angel in disguise. So where does the story go from there? So it's a pretty, you know, interesting story, has been well received so far, and I would love to know your thoughts on it once you're done reading.
Great. I think I should also talk about my book. It is called The Last Love Letter, and there's an interesting story to it as well. So what happened with me was, having written so many, you know, crime, so I my previous book, the before The Last Love Letter, The Last Love Letter was published in June, but 2 months before that, a true crime book came to the market, and it was called Queens of Crime. Queens of Crime I wrote with Bollywood actor Sushant Singh. We had a session in the morning, I don't know whether you attended or not. So these are true stories of women criminals, and very, very disturbing and dangerous stories. It took us almost a year to write, research and write. And I was so tired, I mean, first I thought that men only are criminals, and when I started reading about women as criminals, my, you know, all the, someone was, you know, Anirban was using this fantastic word in the morning, phrase, you know, chemical locha. Dimag mein mere bhi chemical locha ho gaya. So I said, this is too, I mean, I was feeling very uncomfortable. So I thought, why not write a romance novel, you know, maybe as a cure, antidote, because romance is nice. Though I've not been a romance reader in that sense, but I read a lot of romance books in that intermittent period, and I found it very soothing. So one day I woke up in the morning and I declared to my wife, been married for 20 years, as I said, and I said, I'm going to write a romance novel. And she said, please don't. I said, why? Because she said, romance novel likhne ke liye romance aana chahiye. So main, before I ask you people about romance aana chahiye, aap logon ko aata hai ki nahi aata, so I said, okay, male ego. I said, ab to main pakka likhunga. Okay, you've given me a reason to write. And I started writing this romance book fully convinced that I cannot write a romance book, because a romance book will typically not have a villain. How can you write a book without a villain? Because I've been writing all books with villain. So without villain, kaise book likhoge? So I thought probably it'll end up becoming a short story. But let me tell you, you know, ladies and gentlemen, this is something, I'm telling you the sequence of events that has happened. Not only it cured me of all the ill effects of writing Queens of Crime, if I may say, but also it made me realize more about romance. And I thought probably my wife was right. The very act of writing romance novel or reading romance novel is so different, and men tend to move away from reading romance books. They're usually read by women. But when I read quite a few of them, I wrote, I think I was able to take off a lot of layers, and you know, about this, over this word called love. And I think it changed me as a person. It changed me, it made me a better person in understanding relationships, whether it is husband, wife, or this, because we're also exploring through this book mother and a father and a daughter relationship. We're also exploring second love, you know, because the character, the main character, dies in the beginning. So with all that, it's been a very healing sort of a process for me. I think it's made me a far more tolerant, better person. I want to ask you the same thing, one by one. So, you've written 5 romance books for us. Tell me, how were you before the first book, and how has it shaped your overall personality now that you're also married?
Well, I would answer it in 2 ways. So, one, for sure, when I wrote my first book, I was healing from a traumatic relationship. So writing for me was a very cathartic process, right? It helped me overcome. It was like I was expressing the deepest fears of my heart. I was, you know, reaching into recesses that I didn't know existed inside me. So that was definitely one. And I believe not just romance, writing in general does that to you. So even if you're writing a diary, right, at the end of the day, it helps, right?
It does.
Yeah, yeah. The second perspective would be a little, you know, comical take on what you were saying. So again, it's general perception. So if you're a romance writer, it is, you know, it is assumed you are romantic, okay? Because your characters can do things that can make people go, oh, can you, right? So the thing is, as you mature as a person, right, writing about it is one thing and doing it is quite another. So my wife often complains that no one will believe you write romance novels, yeah. So yeah, that should sum it up.
Yeah, great, great. Aditya, tell me. Now, before that, I want to ask you, he mentioned about diary writing. How many of you write diaries here? Please raise your hand. Personal diaries? How wonderful. Okay, hands down. Also, tell me, how many of you write, like reading romance novels? Okay, I just want to take a number. So, can you just keep your hands up? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, quite a few. Okay, hands down. And how many of you like true crime and thrillers? Okay, almost equal. Okay. So, Aditya, I think you've done the best thing of combining romance with four murders. So tell me this writing journey. One book, doctor, you're handling emergencies every day, and doctor is one profession that all of us admire so much for the commitment that you all bring to the table. How has it changed you as a person, this writing experience?
To be honest, I was a non-reader initially. And then I started reading crime fictions, and as a reader, as a writer, I turned into a reader as well, because for being a good writer, you have to be a good reader as well. So I started reading a lot of books, and a few of them I liked, and a few were like, okay, could have been better, and that's how I experimented, and then that brought the author in me. And of course, everybody has a backstory to it, and even I have a story which made me an author.
So what is happening to that story?
It's releasing in September 30th.
No, the real life story.
Sir, it's releasing. The next book is about it.
So, you know, one particular trend which is, you know, only in India is the fact that romance books are written mostly by men. Whereas internationally, it is not so. Romance books are written by women and read by women. And one of the top-selling writers internationally, the only exception is Nicholas Sparks, and as read out in the introduction, that title has already been taken away by Faraz Kazi. So me and Aditya will have to think of someone else, but there's no one else, right? So whether it is Nora Roberts or it is Daniel Steele is the fourth largest selling writer of all time. Nora Roberts is the fifth largest selling writers of all time. So I would just like to explore this with the audience as well. If you have a point, you can just raise your hand. Why is it so that Indian men? क्या वैसे मौका नहीं मिल रहा है रोमांस करने का कि रोमांस नॉवल ही लिख रहे हैं? आई नो डजंस एंड डजंस ऑफ राइटर्स, एंड व्हाई वुमेन आर नॉट राइटिंग रोमांस इन इंडिया? सो ये स्टार्टिंग विद यू.
सो आई थिंक मेन आर द वंस टू सफर अ लॉट, इंडियन मेन.
गिव अ बिग राउंड ऑफ अप्लॉज, राइट? सो जब शादी हो जाएगी ना, तब फिर थोड़ा सा बदल जाएगा. व्हाट अबाउट यू फराज?
So I guess it has a lot to do with unrequited love, right? So most of this... So
Indian women have to be blamed for Indian men becoming writers.
Correct. So the trend started, I guess, post the CB era, right? And when everyone who was an engineer who had an unrequited love story started penning it down. And that also actually contributed to the growth of commercial fiction in India, right? At the end of the day, it's also based on the kind of experiences you have. So as I said, writing is a cathartic process, right? How deep you want to delve into it and lay your life, you know, out there in the open in front of the public, it's up to you, right? So I tend to do that. All writers tend to do that. We all borrow from our personal experiences, right? So when I take writing workshops, the three most important things that I cover for a writer, in fact, I call them a writer's three best friends, are your observation, right? How good an observer you are, right? How much can you retain? What kind of power you have on your subconscious that will throw open doors and throw open words when you are writing, that will address your writer's block, right? The other one is obviously experience. How many people you meet, the books you read, the movies you watch, the places you travel to, right? The different kind of experiences you have, the richer, you know, you get as a writer. And the final one is obviously your vocabulary, right? How I want to word it. So by vocab, I rather say the language that you want to address. So let's just maybe compare a commercial fiction writer with a literary fiction writer, right? So when a commercial fiction, so let's say a literary fiction writer says the walls are blue, obviously there's a metaphor deep hiding somewhere inside that says, okay, the walls are blue because my protagonist is feeling the doldrums. He's sad, he's crying, he's getting over a heartbreak, right? But when a CB says the walls are blue, the walls are actually blue. You don't need to read too much into it, right? So three best friends that I stick to. Writing is pretty simple. Keep it simple.
Okay, great. Talking about romance novels, you know, if you go to Amazon, you buy romance novels from Amazon? You read on Kindle as well? Who all read on Kindle? Please raise your hand. Okay, great. So what happens is when I do the search on Amazon, so usually the top-selling books, the latest trend of the last 2 years, will be under the category of romance novel, will actually be erotica. And the same trend which was there in the West, it started with 50 Shades of Grey, and it is continuing to be there. And this started, I think, about 2 years ago in India. And at my stage, when I was writing The Last Love Letter, I did have this option of maybe, you know, putting the physical, sexual, and the erotic part also in my book. But somehow my book did not demand that. And I have not included that at all, you know. And this is a story of a man who's about 30 years old, you know, who's lost his wife and he's got a small kid, etc. And, you know, the interesting thing is, few of my friends, you know, they said that, Kulpreet, agar tu apne novel mein sex nahi dalega, because, dekho, Netflix mein bhi yehi aa raha hai, Amazon Prime mein bhi yehi aa raha hai, Hotstar mein bhi yehi aa raha hai, toh teri kitab chalne wali nahi hai. मतलब देखो ऐसा है, मैंने सारी जिंदगी अपनी, पहले मैं डिफेंस ऑफिसर था, मैंने अपने मन से नौकरी छोड़ के मैं ये कर रहा हूँ, मैं मोटिवेशनल स्पीकिंग कर रहा हूँ, कल को मैं पिक्चर बनाऊंगा, एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप कर रहा हूँ, जो कर रहा हूँ मैं अपने हिसाब से करूँगा. मेरे हिसाब से इस स्टोरी में ये वाली चीज़ की जरूरत नहीं है. एंड इट जस्ट बीन अबाउट टू एंड हाफ मंथ्स, एंड आई थिंक अमंग ऑल द सेवन बुक्स दैट आई हैव रिटन दिस हैज टर्न्ड आउट टू बी द हाईएस्ट रेटेड बुक एवर, बिकॉज आई रोट इट फ्रॉम माई हार्ट. देर इज नथिंग लाइक दैट. What I want to ask you is, and probably all of us can explore this, is that what really is the space, you know, when you talk about erotica quotient or sex in a romance novel, how important is it? Is it really harakiri not to include it? What do you think, starting with Aditya?
So I think it's not really necessary, because that's something one has to see what the plot demands. And for me, if I'm writing true love, it's taken for granted that something might have happened between them. But it's not necessary that you have to mention it over pages every after every five pages, every 10 pages. It can be pure romance as well.
No, but jo plot wali baat hai, wo chalti nahi hai. Because see, Hindi movies, plot mein jo marji ho, there is going to be an item song at any point that the director wants. Right? And that has got maximum TRP, maximum sales, etc. So we just can't wish this away. So I don't think it's plot driven. I think it is more to do with the safety, because I think a writer feels more comfortable commercially that this will be accepted by publisher and people will enjoy reading it, because it will, you know, do
for the
whatever.
Numbers basically. And you want to again, you want to approach people's deepest desires that they won't talk about in the open. And that's why you had this Hindi magazines, I'm not even going to get into it, that used to, you know, rule the 70s and the 80s. And so the trend has never really gone down, right? The medium has changed, but what they want to read about hasn't really gone down. For me, it's again, if it's essential to the story, I would write about it. I have written erotic scenes, right? I have written sexual scenes. If necessary. If not, then I've just put down my foot. Even when the publishers asked me to steam it up a bit, I've just put down my foot and said, no, I don't think this is going to take it anywhere. So, Meant to Be Together has one sex scene. That's it. Apart from that, it's a pretty straightforward book.
You two guys are far too mature than your age, you know. So, I think, yeah. So, someone is going to ask a question. Yes, please.
What I've usually noticed is that when an erotic scene is being written in an Indian context, it doesn't usually come out that well than when it is written by authors from around the world. Like, supposing you take John Green. So, John Green is a romance writer. The way he will write an erotic scene will not be similar to what an Indian writer would write. So, what technicalities do you, you know, should you pay attention to when you write an erotic scene? Because if, like, most of the times, romance novels take inspiration from real life. So, if you don't include moments of intensity in it, sometimes the plot can lose its essence. So, if you really want to include an erotic scene, how would you go about it, making it sound real and not just Okay. You know.
No, it's a very nice question, and I would like my panelists to respond. So, Aditya, how would you respond to this? Why the treatment of the erotic scenes by the Indian writers is found wanting by readers like her, and John Green writes differently?
I think it's inhibition. Somewhere deep down, we know that what's the society going to say about it? Maybe for a few, this might be the scenario. For others, I think there might not be some experience. Maybe they need a personal experience.
In today's time, people don't have experience?
No.
That is something. I don't know, from the time we've started speaking about sex and erotica, 10 people have got up and go. So, probably it's an indication that...
That's what I'm saying. You know, it's inhibition and what the society
else.
Thinks.
Yeah, inhibition. But, you know, as far as readership is concerned, when you go to Kindle, even books written by unknown Indian writers actually feature right at the top. So, people
with
are reading
sleazy
it.
Covers.
They do not want to talk about it.
With sleazy covers.
With absolutely sleazy covers. Anyway, we're having this interesting conversation, but we can discuss any other aspect related to romance.
One thing
well.
I just want to add, there is actually an award for the worst sex scene of the year, right? It's an international award.
Indian got that award?
No. Indians are not
Thank
even
God.
Nominated. Every
oh,
year
Indians
a West,
are not. So we're nice
Western,
people, that's okay.
Every year a Westerner walks away with it.
Okay. So we're going to continue with this freewheeling conversation. I think it's very interesting. I'm enjoying it very much. I hope you're enjoying as well. But at any stage, like she asked, if you have any question or any experience or any story, so be a part of the process and let's talk about it. So we got one hand going up. So fastest fingers first or fastest hand first. So the girl at the end. Yeah. That one. So.
Hello, my name is Minnie. I just wanted to add to the earlier bit where we talk about why Indian women are not writing romance. I think it's very cultural. That's what I've experienced. That the first point is that when you talk about relationships or indulging in sex before marriage, I think girls per se are not as experimentative as boys. And this, I'm talking on basis of research and statistics. And second is culturally, as a writer, I meet lot of romance writers, women writers. I think there's a lot of inhibition to write about sex scenes. You know, I think I feel they always think that, you know, if I'm going to write so much, people are going to judge my character. So I think it's very, very difficult for a writer to separate me as a woman and me as a writer.
No,
so.
I see your point completely. I think it's a very valid
Thank
point.
You.
But I would like to you know, just comment on this, that when it comes to Indian films,
yeah,
right? So screenwriters write whatever, film producers and makers do whatever, and they get away.
Yeah.
So why is it why different yardstick for filmmakers and nobody judges them, and why only writers are judged? Just my thought.
See, again, I don't know how many women are sitting and writing erotic scenes in Indian films also. I really don't know. I mean, we need to take account on that.
Okay. Yeah, this
but like
that
even when I came for this session, I thought there would be a woman up there.
Oh yes, there should
you
be.
One of you is welcome
to join us. So probably you can or anyone. Yes, you want to ask a question? You want to join us? Yeah, please come. So we have a. Please. Are you a writer, reader? What are you? Or a writer? Please come here. So you can come in from there. That's okay. Take the mic.
I have written, I think, 15 romances. 18 romances. And I think that the conversation about sex needs to move away from inhibition and to consent. So if the panelists can talk about consent, that would be really cool. Especially because a lot of... romance as a genre really gets a lot of flack. I agree with what Minnie thinks because sometimes you are what you write, apparently, especially if you're a woman and you're writing about one-night stands and things like that. But the truth is that we're telling stories about people, and people can be whatever they want to be, and it doesn't matter whether you're a female writer or a male writer and stuff. When it comes to writing romances, I think you'd be really surprised, but I think most romances are written by women, although the really famous ones are written by men. So I'm guessing you guys have the upper hand on that. That's my comment.
Loads of information there. Thank you very much. So any more questions or any... someone else here over there, yeah. Sorry, you can go ahead, yeah. So you got the mic, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, one of you.
Can I carry on?
Yeah, sure. First him and then you.
Okay, so
I know it's ladies first, but then Just hang on for a second.
That's
yeah.
Fine. Okay. So this question is for Aditya Nigar. So he just wrote a romantic thriller. So I really want to know what's the secret between writing a romantic thriller, because there's a high chance that the romance doesn't work out or the thriller doesn't work out. No thrill, no romance. But then again, for someone who has included both in the same book, how do you manage it, Aditya? Like, I really want to know.
First of all, I had nothing to lose. It was my first book, so why not experiment something new? I saw a news somewhere, and that inspired me to write this book. And the social message which is in this book is inspired from a real-life incident. That's what I wanted to blend something. I wanted to try something new, and that's what made way for Until Love Sets Us Apart.
I want to ask the same question to Kulpreet sir. I read In Love with Simran, so
Okay. So thanks for asking that. So In Love with Simran was my experiment at doing a romantic thriller, and so when I write, it is not just about writing and telling a story. It is also kind of discovering myself and discovering about the world around me. So I thought, why not write a story that features a 19-year-old college-going girl whose best friend gets murdered. And because she was in love with a billionaire, and when she goes to the police and says that isko pakdo, isne meri best friend ko maar diya, murder kar diya, tum log kuch nahi kar rahe, police says he's too influential, we do not have proof, and she decides to fake to fall in love with that guy to get proof. So I thought, and I wanted to write this book in first person, so I had to imagine this, a Delhi college, a 19-year-old girl who's not very rich, who's not influential, who's got all the vulnerabilities of today's women. And I wanted to get in her shoes and understand, how will she live in a hostel? How will she go about chasing a case? How will she investigate? What are the resources that are available to us? And let me tell you, it was very, very tough. I thought, had she been a boy or a guy, it would have been very different. So it was a learning experience. And that, I think, as far as I'm concerned, it drives me, because I'm not at that point bothered that much about how the readers are going to react. I'm just thinking about self-discovery and discovering and interpreting the world around me. So that is something by which I wrote In Love with Simran. Have you read it in Love with Simran?
I think I read it. I think the romance was good. I think the erotica was also good.
Okay.
I think, best of both worlds.
Okay,
congrats.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Yeah, the girl over there.
My question is for Mr. Faraz Qazi. You told us that when your first novel was published, you were going through a traumatic relationship. So there's a saying that when you go through a heartbreak, it's very easy for you to write. You become a shyer at the end. So
rockstar dekh ke aa rahi hu?
No. It's a saying that jab dil toot jata hai, to hum shyer to ban hi jate hain, right? So you said that you were going through a traumatic relationship, and then you got married. So after getting,
I got married a lot, like about 7-8 years after that. So
yeah, but then before that you were going through a traumatic heartbreak. Yeah, so was it easy for you to keep the writers under the spell even after you getting married? Was it easier for you to write heartbreak relationships even after you getting married? Because I feel over the time you must be healed with the heartbreak.
So I guess, as I spoke about, I touched upon a very interesting best friend, one of the interesting best friends. That's called experience, right? So that wasn't my only relationship, right? And plus, as a writer, I met a lot of people who had their share of experiences. As a writer, I meet them, I hear their stories. I'm always hungry for stories, right? I'm not as hungry for food as my physique would tell you, but I'm very hungry for stories, right? So that's how I guess, the writer in me has been kept alive. So married or not married, I don't think it really matters. What matters is, you have a good story to tell, and you have the right tools at your disposal to talk about it.
And what about the pain in the story? I mean, the heartbreaks gives us the real pain to express.
Correct.
Ourselves.
So I believe, when you are going through a heartbreak, you tend to go a tad bit overboard when it comes to expressing, because you are writing for yourself at the end of the day, right? But today, when I detach myself, and as a third person, if I look at TMD, though it has had its measure of success and fame and got me 2 national awards and 1 international, whatever, right? So if I look at it from a third person's perspective, I still feel that, I could make it a lot more better, a lot more concise, right? So TMD is, I guess, runs into about 310 pages. It's about 95,000 words, the edited version. The first manuscript which I had written, which was in its raw format, it was somewhere around 130,000 words. You are looking at a magnum opus, right? No one is going to give that kind of a time for a romance novel in the commercial fiction era, right? Maybe in Rushdie's, when Rushdie was at his peak earlier on, mm-hmm. right? Maybe it stood a chance, but not really, because then again, detaching yourself as a writer, detaching that heartbreak, right, and thinking of it from a third person's perspective is what time gives you. So when time heals, you as a writer mature.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. So I was disappointed that some of the audience had left because we started talking about erotica. But I think more number of people have come back. So probably they've gone outside to call their friends. Ki aa jao, masti wali baat idhar hi ho rahi hai. So thanks for coming back. It's nice. I could recognize some people. So yes, what is the next question? Anyone? Yes, please.
So I have another question. When you talked about genres being combined during romance novels, so what I've noticed is romance as a standalone doesn't really work or give much of an doesn't pique the reader's interest. So usually there are other genres combined in it, like horror or suspense, crime, or fantasy maybe. So what works best, and what is the most common, and what genre being combined has more advantages and will lead to a better book in the end?
So, shall I respond to this? So, since I've written a full-fledged romance novel and a romantic thriller, so probably I can respond by saying that it is not about combining the genres. It's actually more about the story. So, I wanted to write the story, as I said, about 19-year-old girl, and it was dealing with murder anyway. So, it became a romantic thriller. And when I was writing this romance novel, you are right, because these kind of, you know, notions can come to your mind, and same time, sometime your publisher might say, ki isme to kuch tadka dalo, masala dalo, kuch horror dalo, kuch aur suspense dalo. All that can happen. But I think as a writer, we also have our inner reader. You know, all writers have got their own inner reader, your inner voice. That has to be satisfied. I was interacting with some of the writers, someone yesterday who said she wrote 80,000 words her book, and then she realized that, you know, this is not working. But she still went to the publisher. And the publisher said, I'm not going to accept this. And then she realized that actually, you know, her own inner voice was saying that not. So she set it aside and wrote something else. So I think it's at the end of the day, if your own inner reader is satisfied, then it is guaranteed that your other reader also is going to be satisfied. So short answer, it's not necessary for you to combine any genres. But if your plot demands, probably you can. Right. So more questions? This happens sometimes before lunchtime. So let's continue with our discussion. So Aditya, after this, so this book is about 2 years old, is that right?
1 year old.
1 year old. And I've seen the phenomenal response that you've got. And I see career as a storyteller bloom from here on. So let's talk about your future projects. And also, have you ever, while writing, visualized your story on screen? अच्छा इसमें तो ये वाला हीरो और ये वाला हीरोइन फिट हो जाएगा. डू यू हैव अ इमेज इन माइंड एंड व्हेन यू राइट?
या व्हाइल राइटिंग आई ऑलवेज सी टू इट दैट आई लिव दोस सीन्स. आई सी सम एक्टर इन इट एंड दैट्स हाउ आई स्टार्ट.
एक्ट्रेस आल्सो ऑब्वियसली एक्ट्रेस. सो हु इज योर फेवरेट एक्ट्रेस?
It's not like that, but it depends. Like for in current generation,
I think still shy, you know. We talk so much, and probably
it's Shraddha Kapoor or Alia Bhatt.
Okay, I've been able to get that. Okay, great.
I start working on the scenes. I imagine them, and I imagine an actor in it. For example, in this book, I imagined Aditya Roy Kapoor and Shraddha Kapoor.
Wow, yeah. Thank you very much. What about you, Faraz? Ye to Pune mein rehta hai, main Delhi mein rehta hu. You stay in Bombay. And I've seen your pictures sometimes I've seen one of the pictures I remember you with running into Shah Rukh Khan somewhere. And I believe you know a few actors as well. So do you have this images of actors and actresses in mind when you write, or real time people?
Not really. I just try to place myself in the character's shoes and try to do justice to the character as much as possible. If it becomes a movie, well and good. If it doesn't, I'm trying to balance the happiness that I get as a writer vis-a-vis the happiness that my readers receive from reading the book. So for me, writing is a communication process as any other communication process. And the essence of any communication process is it doesn't start when my pen touches the paper. Yes, I'm still one of the few old writers that write my first draft with a pen. Oh. Right? And then I edit as I go when I'm typing. So writing for me doesn't start when my pen touches the paper. Writing as a communication process starts right from the time the idea, germinates in my mind. So if I am, if I am the first party in whose mind the idea is germinating, right? Is it the same idea that my reader is grasping when they are reading my book, right? How off am I, or am I meeting my mark, right? That's how successful the writing process is for, that's how I judge whether my writing has been successful.
All right, so you said you write still by pen. That's very, very unusual, because I don't write by pen at all. I stopped it a long time ago. I type on my desktop or my laptop. Yeah. And let me surprise you by saying, in Love with Simran that got mentioned just now, I wrote my entire novel on this cell phone. And it's a me Chinese cell phone, and it has come out very well. So anybody wants to write can try that. What do you do, Aditya? Do you write by pen or on your laptop, or what do you do?
Laptop. I prefer laptop because I think writing on pen, it's tedious, and afterwards we have to find a typewriter or something who can type it for us or it's tedious.
Who's your favorite romance writer, national, international?
John Green.
John Green, okay. Any other choices? Indian? Don't say Gulpreet Yadav because you told me outside, so that's okay.
Yeah.
or Faraz Qazi, so.
I've read all, actually. So, there's no one personal favorite as such, okay. But everyone.
Me and Faraz are going to work harder now. Okay, Faraz, you tell me. Who's your favorite Indian or international writer?
In romance, it's Nicholas Sparks. In India, I've... So, no one really, takes... a similar stage as Nicholas Sparks for me. But yeah, that's it. Nicholas Sparks.
Okay, so how many Nicholas Sparks books lovers, please raise your hands. Nicholas Sparks. Oh my God, nobody. I can't even start speaking about Nicholas Sparks. John Green?
Yeah, the modern day.
Okay, so he's called the modern Indian Nicholas Sparks. So you get the indication. Probably you'll have to tell your PR agency to do something else now.
Nicholas Sparks' way of writing is pretty, I believe, he comes from the old school romance era, right? John Green is more modern, more commercial, more up in tune to what Indian fiction where it's heading, right? So there are the differences. Again, as I said, it's the writing style that I most identify with, and somewhere I grew up reading Sparks, so maybe that's where the media labeled me, because shades of writing started showing up somewhere. So... okay. Never know.
I'm going to ask this question to the audience. Who's your favorite Indian? Before that, reading a romance is a better experience in itself, or watching a romance movie is better? How many for books? Raise your hands. Okay, thank you. Hands down. So, how many for romance movies? Better experience. One, two. मतलब आपको सबको पता है कि literature festival में आए हो तो it's not a film festival, so we should not talk about film. But whatever you might say, but I think films are kind of communication tools that people enjoy more. So we've discussed adaptation, etc. So I'm going to now throw open formally the floor. Whatever questions you might have, we've got about 5 minutes. We got 10 minutes, so question answers, most welcome. Now you can talk about our books, you can ask us about your books or anything that you might have. Yeah, okay, sure.
Here I'd like to talk a little about poetry, or writing about romance in general. I feel that in... sometimes when you have a different native language other than English, it's very hard to communicate or write about romance in English. And so supposing Urdu or Hindi has a certain feel to it, and it is more it's more flexible. It can be used to express a more romantic language, you could say. So what difficulties did you face while writing in English, like writing a romance novel in English and not in your native language?
So I did not face any difficulty, but I've got some interesting inputs to give. But before that, we're going to ask Aditya. Aditya, did you face, is English your first language at home?
Not really. But then I write in English as well as in Hindi. So logo ko decide karne do kya acha hai. I translate the Hindi version in English.
No, but what she's asking is that since English is not your first language, do you find difficulty in expressing the feelings and the emotions that you wanted to do in the way
it is very natural
and impressive?
No, I think I am able to express it, but maybe readers connect to Hindi more than English. Okay. That's my personal experience.
Okay, what do you have to say for us?
So again, brings me to the third best friend which I spoke about, language, right? It's how you express yourself, how comfortable you are, the kind of words you use, the kind of figures of speech you put in there, right? It all depends on how skilled you are as a writer. But her point is also, just taking away from that, it has also led to a kind of an evolution in sorts wherein we see a lot of modern day Indian writers using Hinglish. Somewhere. And I don't know whether it has to do with their comfort or it is just to, make it more pleasurable to the, or make it more accessible to a normal average reader, urban reader, or a tier 2 town reader. I don't know what's the technique behind it, but either way, I do see that it works.
Okay, so I've got an interesting anecdote to share about for English being first language in some people's homes. So when I got married 20 years ago, so me and my wife, we started speaking English as our first communication because she was very comfortable. And somehow the situation became like that. For several years, we were speaking only English to each other. We were comfortable talking in English. So that became our first language at our home. So when my daughter was born, so I was posted at Chennai at that time. I was in the defense services at that time. And my daughter was 3. So we obviously were, since husband and wife speaking to each other in English, we were speaking to the kid also in English. And Chennai, it's easier because everyone else is also speaking in English. Nobody speaks Hindi there. Not very many people. So when she went to school, so once when we called for a first parent-teacher meeting, and she was just a small child of 3 years. And so a teacher said, I said, how's her performance? How's this girl? And the teacher said, ki baki sab kuch to theek hai, she's good, but iski Hindi badi kamzor hai. So I told my wife, yeah, this is not good. This is not fair. I hail from the state of Haryana. My wife is from Delhi. And I said, we are Hindi speaking people. So what if we are speaking English to each other? I mean, at our home, even with my dad, etc., with my brother. But then otherwise, English, Hindi mein toh hum bilkul comfortable hain. Humne ye kya kar diya Hindustani ho ke apne bachche ko kaunsi language sikha di ki bachcha jo hai wo Hindi nahi bol pa raha hai. So I said, we'll correct this. So 6 years later, my second daughter was born. And that time I was posted in Bombay. So what we did, we made a rule. So I told my wife, remember, Hindi is the most important language and we're going to speak to our daughter in Hindi. So we started speaking to her in Hindi and we taught our elder daughter also, who was 6 at that time, that choti sister se baat karna hai, to Hindi mein baat karna hai. So by that time, usko Hindi aa bhi gayi thi. Wo Hindi mein baat karna shuru kiya, agar posted to Delhi. And when my younger daughter started going to school, so one day when we were called for the parent-teacher meeting and I said, how's this girl doing? So the teacher said, baki sab kuch so bahut acha hai, lekin iski English bahut kamzor hai. So, this is the story about language. So, I think whatever, might work for us, I fully agree that maybe, when you talk about poetry and shayari, then you're more comfortable writing that because it comes naturally to you at that point of anguish or whatever. But when it comes to writing stories, the canvas is much larger. And it is not that much about your own emotion. It's about building characters, plot, setting, conflict, etc. All the elements that go into making a good story. So, probably there is room for you to experiment with your second language as well. Which is why I think most of the people are able to write well not in their native languages, but in other languages. So, just my answer. More questions? Yeah?
Hello. I just want to know your thoughts on the commercial aspects of this book industry now. Because what I see is now in the era of self-publishing, there are a lot of authors coming up. And for the readers or for the public, there are a lot of options available to read. And the competition of this is with the web series, Netflix and Amazon Prime. And if you see the commercial also, they are equally balanced. So what do you think what is the future of the industry? How would you like to attract the more public into reading? Because what our experience is, like, people are started reading less and lesser and watching more and more. So how do you see this industry competing with the other one?
Okay, yeah, that's a great answer, great question. I think I can give this answer over next 2 or 3 hours, but I'm not going to do that. So I'll first ask, Aditya to reflect on this. What's your take?
I think writing good stories is going to attract people. So write as many good, like there have to be some, you know, governing body, I can say. And readers are the only governing body. Maybe they are the judges. They are the best judge, and I think when an author writes a good story, if you appreciate it, it's heart pleasing for the author as well. So he's going to come up with another story, and that's how this chain is going to continue.
Yeah, very smart answer for us.
So I guess it totally depends on how, you know, the industry technology is taking over the industry, right? So you are seeing a lot of readers turn to e-books. Then there are a lot of arrogant or ziddy people like me who never, you know, turn to e-books. They still like the smell of paper. But as I see how, you know, people, the new generations, you know, keep coming, their interaction with technology would be, you know, maximum. And automatically, they would be preferring e-books over paperbacks and hardbacks because they would grow up on tech, right? So, from evolution perspective, it definitely would be, technology would be overtaking the content industry. So, now whether you're talking books or Netflix and Hotstar, that's already happening, right? So, it's only going one way, it's up.
So, I agree with their responses, but I've got a very different and a fresh perspective to this because this is something that has been bothering me a lot because I'm a full-time author and I've been doing this since 2014. And it's very important that my books are read and others' books are read as well, and that there is something that I can do or all of us can do to kind of catalyze this industry, which is at the moment facing the kind of you know, difficulty as you've rightly brought out. But I would also like to say that Indian popular fiction industry is untapped. You see, you mentioned about self-publishing. There is too much of average or below average content out there. Any one of you, it's my personal gut feeling, if you really write a moving story, even if you don't push, don't do anything, I think it is going to sell very well. I'll give the example of the film industry, right? When we had this film industry in late 80s, you know, we had very film industry, Hindi film industry was on the verge of dying. We all used to watch only English movies. I'm a product of Nauroji Wadia College here. So till 1990, when I was in college, we were only watching English movies because it used to be down market. For us to say in college, I'm Hindi picture dekhne ja rahe, people say, Hindi picture dekhne ja rahe hai log. Us samay movie kaisi aayi thi, Amitabh Bachchan ki Jadugar. Aur aisi, itni bundle picture aati thi. But somehow the industry also started facing that, and you know, underworld and so many things happened. But they kind of reinvented themselves. And now if you see, another trend has come with the internet coming, with the web series coming. So now the content is further evolving. It is getting sharper and sharper. So I think in this pressure time, the authors will also dive deeper, come up with better content. I think if you write a good story like John Green writes or like anyone else writes, I think you can sell a million copies in India. There is absolutely no dearth. There are a few authors, 2-3 of them, you all know them, you can count them on fingertips. But I think that particular pool can definitely expand. So good content, whether it is written or it has made movies, it is going to sell. I'm going to give you a last example in this because I'm very passionate about this. So I've got an elder daughter who's doing MBA in Ahmedabad and currently she's in US. And she sent me a video from Michigan State University where she's gone on a student exchange program. And she says, Dad, this is so cool. So there's a machine there. It is called the storytelling vending machine. So what happens is, usme teen coins, teen button lage hue hain. One button is 2-minute story. Second button is 5-minute story. Third button is 10-minute story. So it's a story vending machine. So she presses this 5 minutes and just like a bill, a paper pops out. It's free. It's installed in all the universities and the paper pops out and people are reading that. So this kind of renaissance in reading is coming back and I was trying to, I'm very curious about this. So I started searching storytelling vending machine. Kya hota hai? I came to know a French company has found it and I said, acha, kya main khareed ke apne kahin market mein kahin bhi laga sakta hun? So it costs $10,000. So that's prohibitive at the moment. So it's 7 lakh. Then I started thinking as a storyteller, kya main isko bana sakta hun? Kya hum isko bana sakte hain? So anyway, the long story short is that the power of word, you know, even religion,
कितनी सारे सरमंस आ जाएं, बट पावर ऑफ अ रिलीजियस बुक इज ऑलवेज गोइंग टू रिमेन, राइट? शादी का भी कुछ होता है तो सर्टिफिकेट बनता है, कोई भी हम किसी के साथ एग्रीमेंट करते हैं तो डॉक्यूमेंटेशन करते हैं. सो पावर ऑफ वर्ड इज नेवर गोइंग टू गो अवे. आई थिंक 99% ऑफ द स्टफ विच इज आउट देयर इज बिलो एवरेज, बट इवन फॉर दैट आई विल नॉट ब्लेम द राइटर्स, बिकॉज इंडिया इज लार्जली अ नेशन ऑफ नॉन रीडर्स. पीपल डोंट रीड. इन पुणे इट्स डिफरेंट, बट मोस्ट पार्ट्स ऑफ द country people don't care. There are cities cities after cities which does not have bookstores. I'll tell you, West Delhi, which is 1/4 of Delhi, does not have a single bookstore. What to talk about any other place, right? So the ecosystem of publishing industry itself has become weak, which is why some of the people got money, paise se chapaliya, etc. So everyone else is to be blamed. I say, when I go to schools and colleges and corporate lectures that I give, I say India is the only country where a housewife does not make a budget for buying books. पिज्जा का बजट बना लिया, ओके, डोमिनोज से खरीदेंगे, बाहर पिक्चर देखने जाएंगे, बना लेगा मंथली बजट. आई हैव नॉट कम अक्रॉस सिंगल फैमिली हु हैज गॉट मंथली बजट ऑफ बाइंग बुक्स. व्हेन स्कूल गिव्स डंडा, दिस यू हैव टू बाय दिस बुक फॉर व्हाटएवर, यू नो, 20 बुक्स पीपल डोंट बाय बुक्स, राइट? सो इफ दैट चेंजेस, इफ एवरीबडी बाइज बुक्स एंड द पब्लिशिंग इंडस्ट्री गेट्स रिवाइटलाइज्ड, देन ऑब्वियसली बेटर राइटर्स will find it a lucrative option to come. They will dive deeper, they'll write better stories. So it's a kind of a complex cycle. That's how it is. Anyway, the takeaway is that for all of you, I think I'm getting signals that the time is getting over, is that do whatever, but unfortunately the last love letter has got only 2 copies remaining, but I've got in love with Simran 4 or 5 copies remaining. Not more than that, I'll be very happy to sign, and so goes for these 2 wonderful authors. And if you're not able to buy our books, please do buy. It's just 100 bucks, 150 bucks from Amazon. Do reading, do keep writing. Yeah, so sorry, I took a little bit longer, but just give me 1 more minute. So I would like to invite Aditya to give his closing remarks, and after that to Faraz.
Yeah, hello everybody. Thank you for coming here in numbers, first of all. And yeah, my copies are available here, Until Love Sets Us Apart. And do come there. I will sign the copies for you, and I hope you'll enjoy reading the book. Thank you for coming.
Well, I'm very bad with closing remarks, so let me keep it simple. Thanks for showing up in great numbers. This is one of the few sessions I've had this kind of an attendance, apart from my launches. Thanks for showing up. Read my books. I'm very approachable on social media, so share your feedback. That's how we improve. And we are always hungry to hear about how, you know, what people liked, what people disliked, critique, right? Give us your bricks and bats. Always open for that. That's welcome. Thanks again.
Okay, thank you very much. Big round of applause for these authors and for all of you.